9 years in the CFL, 9 seasons in the red and white, 2 Grey Cup wins, everything left on the field.
Jon Cornish up the middle, goodbye, touchdown, make it 3, hat trick, Jon Cornish.
After an entire professional career spent with the Calgary Stampeders, Jon Cornish achieved everything a player of the highest caliber could. 2 Grey Cup wins, the 2013 League Most Outstanding Player, the Most Outstanding Canadian Player, 3 times, the single season Canadian rushing record holder with 1,813 yards, and the Lou Marsh Award winner in 2013 for the best athlete in all of Canada. But through all the highs and lows and through all the adversity, John never lost sight of his love for the sport. Beginning at the age of 12, football was a passion for John. Amassing 3,200 career yards and 49 touchdowns in high school, he was a 3-year letter winner for St. Thomas More High. Not only prolific on the offensive side of the ball, he finished high school with 37 quarterback sacks, a school career record. Joining the Kansas Jayhawks football program, John was awarded the John Hadle Award for Most Valuable Offensive Player of the Year in only his junior year. His performance that year prompted the Stamps to select him in the 2006 draft. In Cornish's senior year, he rushed for 1,457 yards with the Jayhawks, making him the all-time single-season rushing leader at the University of Kansas, a record that he still holds to this day. Joining the Stampeders in 2007, John contributed on special teams before breaking through during the 2010 season.
Jon Cornish in the game. Jon Cornish springs this, kicks it outside. But will be dropped. No, he won't. Still going. And finally out inside the 10.
His enthusiasm for the game was always prominently on display. Finishing his career with 6,844 rushing yards and 44 touchdowns, along with 1,666 receiving yards and 9 touchdowns, John certainly left it all on the field.
And Jon Cornish getting away, breaking tackles, and into the open field! Anybody going to catch him? What a run by Jon Cornish, touchdown!
And now, in his new role with the club as game day ambassador, cheering on the team from the sidelines and pumping up the fans, John's passion for football and the Stampeders endures. As the best player in the CFL at his position, Jon Cornish represented all that is great with the red and white and with Calgary.
I wouldn't be here if it wasn't for the wonderful support I had from Catherine Schneider. Dr. Catherine Schneider, she's one of the key reasons I'm here speaking today at CIRC. And she's one of the key reasons I have had such a great post-concussion life. I mean, when you have a person like that, you know, who takes care of you, like all of you out in the audience, you know, you have made such an impact on the lives of people with concussions and those kinds of post-traumatic kind of injuries to the brain. I think the role that you play, I will dig into it, and it cannot be understated how important that role is. So I am a football player, or at least I was, and I was a pretty good one, I think. I think, as Kim mentioned, back in the day, I loved the game of football. And for me, it was about achievement. You know, I set big goals for myself, and I think I achieved most of those goals. But, you know, like everybody in sport, I only had that level of success because I had an outstanding support network around me. So what I'm going to talk to you today about is my experience with injuries, specifically concussions, sort of the things that I ended up doing to prevent those things from happening again once I returned to field and returned to play. And then my thoughts on how you deal with concussion in prevention as an athlete and what might be helpful to you as practitioners. So starting off, you know, I've had a number of injuries in my life, and I was always told my doctors, you know, John, it seems like you have a pretty high pain tolerance. And maybe that was the case. But for me, I remember all the way back, you know, I had the Osgood Schlatter when I was in grade five, running around with that, still faster than everybody else on the field. But I had a definite limp. You just play through those things. I mean, I ended up having turf toe, grade 11. But you know, you still limp to the win. And I think a lot of athletes end up doing that. You play through injury. The thing is, concussion is so much different where you can't. I had torn my rectus femoris. That was a great experience for me at this point. But you know, sort of back in the day, I needed to learn sort of what my own limitations were. And what the limitations of the trainers were. Well, this is in college. When I was in spring training one year, I caught a kick, caught a ball, and then just started running upfield. And then it was just like, oh, I thought somebody threw a football at my leg. I was looking around for the football, and it was nowhere to be found. Go over the sideline, resistance checked out. Looks like I'm strong enough. But I know something's wrong in there. Like I said, it was spring. So I go home for spring break. I come back down and my muscle had rolled right up. So the training staff still didn't want to sort of admit that I was running around with a torn quadriceps. So they told the coach that I was good to go. So I needed to take myself out of football and put myself down on the sidelines. Unfortunately, that led to me being in the doghouse. I mean, you guys play such a role in the protection of athletes that I can't understate how important that role is, especially when it comes to time to decide whether players should play or not. I think, you know, sometimes it's like, okay, well, you get to make the call as a player. But I think, you know, the role that you play in providing players information is super important. I know for me, having to take myself out, sort of being on an island, it led to the head coach coming over to the sidelines, whispering in my ear, "John, you're a pussy." Because I didn't have the support of my training staff. I ended up just, you know, sort of being in the doghouse for a long period of time. I didn't end up starting in college until most of the running backs had either, you know, dealt with some educational things, some criminal things, some domestic things. Then I got my start and the rest is history. Now there's the Jon Cornish trophy, which goes to the best Canadian in NCAA football. So that was great, but it was because I learned to sort of navigate and how to work with trainers, right? Like, you have to be honest and players have to be honest with their trainers. And if you aren't honest with us, and you know, there's a give and take there that needs to be open and transparent. You know, when it comes to, you know, my football career, I didn't have too many injuries as a professional. At that point, I had figured out how to protect myself. But at the same time, where, you know, injuries could come from, or there's sort of those unknown unknowns, right? It's like, okay, I'm doing the prehab on the shoulders. I'm doing the, you know, stretching. I'm getting the Tai Chi, getting the yoga in. But, you know, nothing can prevent somebody going outside the rules of the game and arm bar in your face, as I learned in 2014. You know, I was on the field having a pretty good game. I had a nice little touchdown, 20-yard carry. It was beautiful. You know, come out next drive, have a nice little catch coming out the same way, and then just bow. I call it an asymptote, right? Like, you know, that sort of a gap between a function, right? Like there is just a space there that I will never be able to account for. I can account for all the times I've slept, all the times I've been awake, you know, different states of consciousness. I can account for those, but I can't account for that period of time after I was hit in the face, right? I was going full acceleration and then I caught the arm and sort of had my head go one way and my body go another. I laid on the field in front of 30,000 people for about 15 seconds. Some people say 30 seconds, some people say 5. But I know that there's an ambulance on the field, right? When I come to, I know that everything stopped. But what I don't know is why I'm wearing football pads. Why am I wearing football pads? So everybody looks really worried and they help me up. I can get up under my own power. I'm just like, what the hell is going on? So we go into the, you know, the medical facility. It's like, okay, I guess this makes sense. I don't know what's going on. But I managed to convince the doctor when he asked me a series of questions that I didn't score a touchdown. It's like, I don't remember playing a football game, let alone scoring a touchdown. To this day, that is the touchdown that I've scored that I have least memory about. And they're all memorable experiences. That's the one I remember the least about. So I was diagnosed with a concussion. I took the SCAT test. I went through the whole protocol. You know, a week later, I didn't really get better. You know, like they put me through the dark room. You know, what was, you know, probably best was that I didn't go watch, you know, Transformers in 3D the day after my concussion. Probably a bad idea. But, you know, at the end of the day, I thought, where could I get better? How could I get better? Because the headache I had didn't go away. It was just there. And when I was filling out the SCAD test every day, it was of low value because I didn't really think I was mentally had an issue. I thought that there was something physically wrong with me. And waiting, just sitting back and waiting, and, you know, protocols have changed. The dark room is lessened now and more social interaction, reading, like the sort of like somewhat pushing yourself. That's now. But they were just coming out with all these protocols back in the day. And I struggled with trying to find something that worked, right? We went through a whole bunch of different things. But I found, and eventually it was made clear to me, that my issue wasn't necessarily that of a concussion. Of course, I was concussed at some point. But because I was referred to a person like Dr. Catherine Schneider, only at that point, we start working on the vestibular things, working on the neck, treating the different issues that sort of came from having your head go one way and your body go another. Rather than treating the injury as just a concussion, we started treating it as, let's say, a collision, whiplash. And that's when I started getting better. The mindset of somebody post-concussion is very weird. It can be sort of cloudy, unsure, depressed, sad, sometimes weirdly exuberant. You know, we don't necessarily understand all those different things. And I'm so happy that people like yourselves are doing the work right now to make sure that, you know, we don't treat concussions the same way as we do as other injuries. But there's still people that say, shake it off. Oh, she just got her bell rung, right? Those things that everybody has heard over their lives. That's just not the case anymore. And I realized that when I had my concussion playing a sport like football, why am I going to, you know, sort of put myself in a vulnerable state? Why am I going to go back out there on the field too early, potentially re-injuring myself and sort of some of the things I'd seen, you know, those people that come back too early. Those are those bad cases, right? I know a lot of people might, talk about different things. I like to bring up the example of Antonio Brown, right? He had a devastating concussion many years ago at this point. And since then, his activities have been all over the place, right? As evidenced just the other day as well. For me, when I see him, I see sort of, let's say, the precursors to CTE. I think that's definitely a place where, yeah, it could be a problem. But I would also say that he shouldn't have been back playing football in the first place after his concussion. So the lack of support from trainers, the lack of sort of that big picture understanding. Of course, you know, we can't diagnose CTE at this point and stuff, but with the sort of insanity of his activities, I think it's plain to see. It's one of those sad things that not enough people were pulled out. Not enough people were stopped from playing. And this is especially sad when you see younger people have concussions and issues that should lead to them ceasing play. But I know I made a decision as I came to on my own was to focus on what I could do. I can play this season. I can finish that out and we'll go from there. Luckily, managed to win a Grey Cup. I still led the league in rushing despite missing half the season. winning top Canadian that year. You know, it's one of those things where you do not know what you have left in the tank unless you go out and find out. But I knew I was ready to come back because I took that time for myself. A longer return to play post-concussion is something that should be encouraged. There shouldn't be that rush back. Oh, you got to get back for this. You know, long-term, that your health is the only thing that matters. And I think for the players, your athletes, making sure that they feel confident and comfortable with the decision to stay out of play while they recover is something you can help with. So I became a target, right? You win, you know, top Canadian three times, win MOP, Grey Cup, and Canada's top athlete. Yeah, you get a target on your back. One of the things is I ended up breaking my thumb the following year because so many people were smashing their helmets into mine intentionally. The ball might be down the field and then somebody comes up and just bow. Right? When it comes to protecting yourself post-concussion, it is super important. Players have to be hyper-aware. They have to get on that rehab more than ever. You have to be more conscious of how you block. I was pumping more air in my helmet. I made different situations. I wasn't normally tackling players at this point in time as I was on offense. But if the quarterback threw an interception, I was deciding to tackle differently, protecting myself. But at the same time, I knew that there was a limit to how much I could protect myself. So I made a decision to retire. I fortunately happened to work for the bank. You know, I put my time in, became an advisor, I had my securities license. You know, I had a job waiting for me in an office downtown after I retired. You are all in a position to help athletes figure out what's going on next week, next game, or for the rest of their life. I mean, my personal trainer, Pat Clayton, connected me to Lynn Tanner, who connected me to Jim Davidson, who wrote out my business plan to get me from point A to point F and now into my career. My personal trainer did that for me. I would implore all of you out there to make those connections, to help people see that if concussions are that bad, there's other things in life. And trust me, those other things, they ain't that bad. So thank you so much. Thank you to Cirque for having me today. I thank you for Kim for hosting a wonderful day. Thank you for the recording, Cammy. Thank you so much. And Alma, and I hope you all have a great rest of the conference. All the best.